Hello everyone, welcome to Machine Learning Laboratory. Today we will discuss program number 8, that is expectation maximization algorithm. Let us first see the problem statement. The problem statement for program number 8 is: apply EM algorithm to cluster a set of data stored in a .csv file. Use the same data for clustering using k-means algorithm. Compare the results of these two algorithms, that is EM algorithm and k-means algorithm, and comment on the quality of clustering. You can add Java or Python ML library classes or APIs in the program. The k-means algorithm works as follows. First, we will initialize k points called as means. That is done randomly. Then we categorize each item to its closest mean, and we update the mean's coordinates, which are the averages of the items categorized in that mean so far. We then repeat the process for a given number of iterations, and at the end we have our cluster. The expectation maximization algorithm is a way to find maximum likelihood estimates for model parameters when our data is incomplete and has missing data or has unobserved latent variable, that is hidden variable. It is an iterative way to approximate the maximum likelihood function. While maximum likelihood estimation can find the best fit model for a set of data, it doesn't work particularly well for incomplete data sets. Let us understand the EM algorithm with a simple example. Assume that we have two coins, C1 and C2. Assume that the bias of C1 is theta1, that is probability of getting heads with coin 1, C1 is theta1. Assume the bias of C2 is theta2, that is probability of getting heads with coin C2 is theta2. We want to find theta1 and theta2 by performing a number of trials, that is the coin tosses. First experiment, we will choose 5 times one of the coin randomly. We toss the randomly chosen coin 10 times. When we choose first coin, that turns out to be coin B. This chosen coin B is now tossed 10 times. The result is head, tail, 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 head, head, tail, head, tail, head. Like this, we will continue 5 times, and the chosen coin is tossed for 10 times. The result is shown in the figure. Then we calculate theta1 and theta2. Theta1 is probability of the coin 1 getting head. Theta2 is probability of the second coin getting head. Theta1 is equal to number of heads using coin 1 divided by total number of flips using C1. In case of theta 1, the number of heads using coin 1 is 5 and total number of flips which we have done using coin 1 is 10. When we substitute these values, theta 1 becomes 5 upon 10. Similarly, for theta 2, the number of heads using coin 2 is 9 and number of flips is as usual 10. Theta 2 becomes 9 divided by 10. Like this, we will calculate the number of heads and number of tails we got when we toss coin A and coin B, and we will write the results in a table as shown in the figure. Even we will calculate the total number of heads and tails for coin A and coin B. For coin A, we have 24 heads and 6 tails, whereas for coin B, total number of heads is 9 and total number of tails is 11. With this, we can calculate the probability of getting heads with coin A and coin B. For coin A, theta 1 is equal to 24 divided by the total number of tosses, that is 24 plus 6, that turns out to be 0.8. Whereas for theta 2, the number of heads is 9, that divided by total number of flips which we have done, that is 9 plus 11, that turns out to be 0.45. This calculation is possible when we know the identity of the coin which we are flipping, that is whether the coin we got randomly is B or A. Let us move towards more challenging aspect, that is, we do not know the identities of the coins used for each set of tosses. That is, when we pick randomly the coin, we don't know whether the coin is A or B. Since we don't know the identity of the coin, that is, whether the selected coin is A or B, we cannot calculate the probability. We will assume the probability of getting head for coin A is 0.6 and that for coin B is 0.5. In EM algorithm, first step is to assume the probabilities as we have done here, that is theta A is equal to 0.6 and theta B is equal to 0.5. These values we have assumed. After this, we will try to maximize the assumption we made. In the first round, as you can see, we have 5 heads and 5 tails when we tossed the coin. We will calculate the likelihood using binomial distribution. The formula is capital P is equal to theta raised to k into 1 minus theta raised to n minus k. Here, capital P is probability of coin 1 getting head. Theta is equal to probability of coin A, which we have assumed as 0.6. K is the number of heads that we have taken here as 5. N is the total number of trials. In our case, we have 10 trials for each of the coin. Substituting the values, we will get the likelihood of the coin A getting head as 0.0007962. Similarly, for coin B, the likelihood of getting head is 0.0009765. We will normalize these results since we are placing them in a probability form. Normalizing likelihood of A is equal to A upon A plus B. That turns out to be 0.45. This value is probability of coin 1 getting head. Similarly, the normalized value for likelihood of B is 0.55. That is, it shows the probability of coin B getting head as 55%. Next, we will estimate the likely number of heads and tails for first toss. For coin A and B, we will calculate the probability of getting head and probability of getting tail. The probability of coin A getting head is equal to probability of getting coin A into total number of heads. That equals to 0.45 into 5. That turns out to be 2.2. The probability of coin A getting tail is equal to probability of getting A into total number of tails. That value is 0.45 into 5. That turns out to be 2.2. Similarly, we will calculate for coin B also. In case of coin B, capital H is equal to 2.8 and capital T turns out to be 2.8 only, since the number of heads and tails we got when we flipped the coin is 5 only. Let us summarize the first experiment. In the first experiment, we took two coins and randomly picked one of the coin. We don't know whether the coin is A or B. This coin we have flipped 10 times. We have assumed the probability of the coin we have selected may be capital A as 0.6 and theta B, that is the probability that the coin we have selected can be B as 0.5. Then we have calculated the likelihood using binomial distribution. We got the values as 0.45 and 0.55. This value indicates the likelihood of the coin as capital A is 0.45, and likelihood that the coin we have selected is capital B as 0.55. Then we have calculated the probability of coin A getting head and getting tail. That we got the values as 2.2 and 2.2. Then we have calculated the probability of head and tail for coin B. That value we have got as 2.8 and 2.8. The values are same because in the first experiment, when we flipped the coin, the number of heads and the number of tails are same. The same experiment is again conducted for 4 more times and the values are tabulated as shown in the figure. After this, we will again calculate the probability. The probability of coin A getting head is equal to the total number of heads we got in case of coin A, that is 21.3, divided by total number of heads and tails, that is 21.3 plus 8.6. That value we will get as 0.71. Similarly, we will calculate the probability of coin B getting head as theta B is equal to total number of heads in case of coin B, that is 11.7, divided by total number of heads and tails, that is 11.7 and 8.4, the value turns out to be 0.58. If you remember, we have assumed the value of theta A and theta B as 0.6 and 0.5. Then we have calculated the most likelihood using the binomial distribution. We got the values as 0.71 and 0.58. These values now we will replace with the assumed value. Now our new value of theta A and theta B are 0.71 and 0.58. We will repeat the same above steps to find out new probability values. We will repeat this till we will get constant values for theta A and theta B. Again, there is a possibility that we will get new values of theta A and theta B. The iteration will continue. We will repeat this till we will get constant values for theta A and theta B. That is, both iterations need to get theta A and theta B same values. This will happen when theta A is equal to 0.80 and theta B is equal to 0.52. Now we can say that we got the best results. This example shows the working of EM algorithm. In our example, we have first assumed the value of theta A and theta B. Then we tried to maximize our expectation by calculating binomial distribution. And at the end, when the values in the iterations are stable, that we have considered as final probability values. The EM algorithm is an iterative approach that cycles between two models. The first mode attempts to estimate the missing or latent variables, called the estimation step or E step. The second mode attempts to optimize the parameters of the model to best explain the data, called the maximization step or M step. For the lab experiment, we will apply the EM algorithm to cluster a set of data which is stored in a comma separated value file, that is .csv file, and we will use the same data set for clustering by using the k-means algorithm, and we will compare both the results, that is for EM algorithm and for k-means algorithm. Suppose we measure a single continuous variable in a large sample of observations. Suppose that the sample consists of two clusters of observations with different means and probably different standard deviations within each sample. The distribution of values for the continuous variable follows the normal distribution. The goal of EM clustering is to estimate the means and standard deviations for each cluster so as to maximize the likelihood of the observed data. We can put this one in another way. The EM algorithm attempts to approximate the observed distribution of the values based on mixtures of different distributions in different clusters. The results of EM clustering are different from those computed by k-means clustering. The k-means clustering will assign observations to clusters to maximize the distance between clusters. The EM algorithm does not compute the actual assignments of observations to clusters, but classification probabilities. In other words, each observation belongs to each cluster with a certain probability. As a final result, we can usually review an actual assignment of observations to clusters based on the classification probability. In case of k-means clustering, the algorithm will categorize the items into k group of similarity. To calculate that similarity, we will use Euclidean distance as measurement. The k-means algorithms works as follows. First, we will initialize k points called as means, and that we'll do randomly. We categorize each item to its closest mean and we update that mean's coordinates, which are the averages of the items categorized in that mean so far. We repeat the process for a given number of iterations, and at the end we have our clusters. The points mentioned here are called means because they hold the mean values of the items categorized in it. To initialize these means, we have a lot of options. An intuitive method is to initialize the means at random items in the data set. Another method is to initialize the means at random values between the boundaries of the data set. We will initialize the means with values for x at 0,3. We will use IRIS dataset for this experiment. The IRIS dataset is originally published at UCI Machine Learning Repository IRIS dataset. This small dataset from 1936 is often used for testing out machine learning algorithms and visualizations. The IRIS dataset includes 3 IRIS species with 50 samples each, as well as some properties about each flower. One flower species is linearly separable from the other two, but the other two are not linearly separable from each other. The attributes in IRIS dataset are ID, sepal length in centimeter, sepal width in centimeter, petal length in centimeter, and petal width in centimeter. Last column will indicate the class, that is species. Each row of the table represents an IRIS flower, including its species and dimension of its botanical parts, sepal and petal in centimeters. Some instances from the dataset are shown. We will execute this program in Spider and observe the output. We will see some of the commands which are used in this program. Import matplotlib.pyplot as plt. Matplotlib is a plotting library for the Python programming language and its numerical mathematics extension NumPy. It provides an object-oriented API for embedding plots into applications using general purpose GUI toolkits. PyPlot is Matplotlib's plotting framework. Import line merely imports the module matplotlib.pyplot and binds that to the name plt. Sklearn or scikit-learn. It is a Python library that offers various features for data processing that can be used for classification, clustering, and model selection. Scikit-learn is a free machine learning library for Python. It features various algorithms like support vector machine, random forest, and k nearest neighbors. It also supports Python numerical and scientific libraries like NumPy and SciPy. We are also importing k-means from sklearn.cluster. We will give the pandas the alias name pd and NumPy the alias name np. Iris is equal to datasets.load_iris function. Load iris is a function from sklearn. Iris in this code will be a dictionary like object. Capital X is equal to pd.dataframe inside bracket iris.data. X and Y will be NumPy areas here. Pandas data frame is imported to capital X. After importing, capital X will look like the one table shown in the figure. X.columns is equal to sepal length, sepal width, petal length and petal width. The column names are given as shown in the figure. Y is equal to pd.dataframe inside bracket iris.target. Y.columns is equal to targets. As we have seen, X and Y will be NumPy arrays. Pandas data frame, that is target, or what we call it as a class, is imported to Y. The column name is given as targets. Model is equal to k means inside bracket n_clusters is equal to 3. Model.fit of X. This code will build the k-means model. Fit will compute k-means clustering. plt.figure inside bucket fig size is equal to 14 by 14. The purpose of using plt.figure function is to create a figure object. The figure is being created explicitly using plt.figure so that the figure will be a specific size rather than the default size. The figure size attribute allows us to specify the width and height of a figure in unit inches. This code will create a figure object which has a width of 14 inches and height of 14 inches. The values of the fig size attribute are a tuple of two values. plt.subplot inside bracket 2, 2, 1. Here three integers, n rows, n columns and n index. The subplot will take the index position on a grid with n rows, rows and n columns as columns. Index starts at 1 in the upper left corner and increases to the right. Means here 2 will indicate number of rows, again 2 will indicate number of columns and 1 will indicate the index, which will start at the upper left corner. plt.subplot will create a single subplot within a grid. This command takes three integer arguments, the number of rows, number of columns and the index. plt.scatter, it's a scatter plot. It is a diagram where each value in the dataset is represented by a dot. The matplotlib module has a method for drawing scatter plots. It needs two arrays of the same length, one for the value of the x-axis and one for the values of the y-axis. From sklearn, import preprocessing. The sklearn.preprocessing package provides common utility functions and transformer classes to change raw feature vectors into a representation. There are four main important steps for preprocessing of the data: splitting of the data into training and validation sets, taking care of the missing values, taking care of the categorical features, and normalization of the data set. Preprocessing dot standard scalar function. It transforms the data in such a manner that it has mean as 0 and standard deviation as 1. In short, it standardizes the data. Standardization is useful for data which has negative values. It arranges the data in a standard normal distribution. Scalar.fit inside bracket capital X. Fit means training. There is a fit function in machine learning that is used for training of model using data examples. Fit function adjusts the weights according to data values so that better accuracy can be achieved. After training, the model can be used for predictions using predict method. XSA is equal to scalar.transform inside bracket capital X. Transform function. Parameters generated from fit method applied upon model to generate transformed data set. XS is equal to pd.dataframe inside bracket XSA, comma columns is equal to x.columns. Pandas data frame is a two-dimensional size mutable potentially heterogeneous tabular data with labeled axes. It means rows and columns. Next we have Gaussian mixture model which is implemented in this program. What is Gaussian mixture model? Gaussian mixture model is a probabilistic model which represents normally distributed subpopulations within an overall population. Mixture models in general don't require knowing which subpopulation a data point belongs to. Import Gaussian mixture. Gaussian mixture model attempts to find a mixture of multidimensional Gaussian probability distributions that best model any input data set. Gaussian mixture models can be used for finding clusters in the same manner as k-means clustering. That we will write it as from sklearn.mixture import GMM. GMM.fit inside bracket XS. This will estimate the model parameters with the EM algorithm. When we execute this program, we will get the three plots as shown in the figure. The first plot is real clusters, which will show the data points as dots and with three colors, red, green, and black. The same now is being given as input for k-means EMM. If you see the plot carefully, we can notice that GMM clustering is more promising than k-means clustering. The data points are clustered really well in case of GMM clustering rather than in k-means clustering. This result is printed as the GMM using EM algorithm based clustering matched the true labels more closely than the k-means.